Welcome everybody to lecture 6, Information Retrieval in the Winter Semester 2017-2018. So this is one of my favorite lectures about web applications. Quite challenging for me, hopefully entertaining for you. There are very few of you here. I will come back to this in a second. So your experiences with exercise sheet 5, which was about fuzzy prefix search, very interesting applications. And then the contents today is we will build a search web application, part 1. We will do a lot of live coding and you have to help me. We will talk about sockets for the communication between several machines and then about hypertext and everything concerned with that. The exercise will be to build a web application on top of what you have already done for the last exercise sheet. So you have basically built a command line tool where you type something, you press return, and then you get hits, and now you do that in the browser using all this stuff here, sockets, hypertext. So that's quite interesting. It's not so much work, but you have to understand all these technologies behind. So it's actually split in 2 parts so that you don't have so much work. So there's a static web application for this exercise sheet, and then for the next exercise sheet next week, you will make it dynamic using JavaScript. And I will show you more about this in a second. But let's first talk about the last exercise sheet a bit. That was fuzzy prefix matching. So many of you like the application. I mean, it's really useful. You know it from your own searches, and it's even more useful if you just have to type a little bit, just the beginning, and even there you can make mistakes. So that's really cool. So it was relatively time intensive for many. However, many of you said yourself that it was not because of the difficulty. I mean, it wasn't easy, but it wasn't super hard. But yeah, I mean, you just programmed and you had something and then you spend like 10 hours on debugging. That's what many people wrote. So here are 2 pieces of advice. So one reason is that's clear from the feedback that many of you just still lack basic programming practice, so somehow missed out in previous courses. That's of course fine, but so now you're learning it, right? I mean, programming takes practice. It's nice, it's interesting, but you just have to practice. And the other thing, I think, this is what I'm also reading from the comments, a lack of concentration. So programming is not something you should do in the middle of the night, at the end of the day, especially on a Monday when Tuesday is the submission deadline. This is really important. It's not only that it takes a little bit longer, but it takes 10 times longer. Why? What's happening? You're just not very concentrated, not very focused. You make a small mistake, you forget something, some detail, and then it gets all messed up. And then you don't realize that you should just start again, but then you have some mess and then hours just to find a stupid mistake. You all know this, right? It's really a lack of concentration thing. So implementation exercise is actually something which you should do when you are well rested and fresh, right? So the difference is in time is not like 50%, it's a factor of 3, 4, 5, right? If you're not concentrated, you can spend hours on really stupid stuff. So there were some minor changes in the data set and the tip file, but let me just show you this. I mean, we have a forum, here it is, and there's an announcement section, right? And so, okay, I mean, with a different account here, so everything is unread. Some minor changes in the data set code and tip file. Actually, you can subscribe to the forum, right? Then you get an email, or you should just check it regularly, right? So this was posted on Wednesday. I mean, of course, it would be better if we don't make any changes and everything is perfect, right? But I mean, our exercises are, yeah, they're real data sets. We were like working forever on this data set. And then, of course, we make a mistake every now and then. I think that's normal. But you really have to read this. So many of you wrote they started coding and then they found out something doesn't quite fit. I mean, just subscribe to the forum or just check it regularly, right? And then you see, oh, there's a small change. I mean, we are almost perfect, but there are small mistakes, right? So please do that, right? Subscribe to the forum. Okay, about the results, let's look at the result table here. That was from the last exercise sheet. Here we go, many results. So what do we see? We had three queries, the, which is of course, let's try to understand these columns here for a second. The is of course very ambiguous. Maybe we should try one of your solutions and see how it works. So I think there was, where am I now? Jay, one of you, who has a nice solution? Who used yellow to highlight the results? I forgot the account. I think it's YL. It's YL, yeah. I think it was a Chinese girl, right? I think that was, let's just, I mean, many of you had nice solutions, but I like this a lot, so let's just compile this. This compiles QGram index. Let's just do this. I think it's very nice. Entity file, you get help. This, if you just type it without arguments, so it needs the file. The file is on our file system. Teaching information retrieval. 1718, and then it's Wikipedia entities.tsv, and let's also use synonyms. Now it's building the index. Actually, we can have a look at how much space this uses. So let's filter by Q, F4, Q, gram index. Am I on the wrong machine here? Why doesn't it show anything? I'm on Aetna here, right? I'm on Aetna here. Filter? Shouldn't it... there it is. Okay, so you see it's using 1.4 gigabyte, right? The Java program uses 4 point something or 5 gigabytes, right? Which is a very important point about Java. Java is incredibly wasteful about space and there's little you can do about it. That's a bit unfortunate. So now let's type the and you get results, right? Actually, I changed the color to blue so you can see it better, right? Searching for the. Now you get United States of America as the state, so one of the synonyms, because of the, you find this and so on. Right? So here's a synonym. So if I type USA, I will also find United States of America, right? It's not really a prefix search thing, but prefix search for the synonym. So this is really nice. It works really well. So this was, how many entities did we have? 3 million? And the naive approach was you go through all the 3 millions and you do this edit distance computation, which was this matrix which you had to compute, right? 3 million times, that costs a lot of time. So here, by our QGram index approach, you only had to compute it for 50,000, right? Which takes some time, but some of you managed to get it really fast, like below 50 milliseconds, and then you get 50,000 results. Now for Bribe, let's do Bribe and see what happens. Yeah, Breibig, actually Freiburg and Breisgau is third. You have other things which are more similar. Village in United Kingdom. It's Wikidata, so it's everything basically in the world, but it's really fast. So you get 27,000 PD computations, 279 results, right? And the Big Lebowski, let's also type this here, which is badly misspelled. And you get the Big Lebowski, right? Despite all these spelling mistakes and so on. And here you get, yeah. You have to check 2,000 entities, which might be similar. In the end, it's only one, which actually has the right edit distance, yeah? So let me go back to the slides. So we had these three queries. So this was a very ambiguous query. Still, by the QGram index, you only had to check 2% of the entities. You had to do the actual computation. For Bribe, it was below 1%. And for this more specific query, which is more typical for what users type, it's only 0.07. So only a fraction of the data you actually have to look at in more detail. Best query times are below 50 milliseconds, even for the hardest query. Which was the, so that's really fast and it's a big data set, yeah. So there was a lot of variation in running time. You see it here, some seconds and then 200, some 36. And some Java codes are faster than some of the C++ codes. Yeah, so there are also studies about this. It's not that you use one language, you're always faster. It depends on a lot of details. Yeah, you can do a lot of things wrong or inefficiently, but the fastest query times are with C++, like 20 milliseconds or so. And this I already mentioned. Yeah, Java uses a lot of space, and unfortunately, there's very little you can do about it. It's the array lists and there's just space overhead in Java, which is built in, which is you can't, and there's the garbage collector, which is running at some point. You can't really say run now or be more efficient with my space. It's really a problem. Okay, let's go to the lecture contents of today. Any questions about the sheet? Maybe to go back to this one, to the time intensive, this is 1/4 of the audience of this lecture. We have over 100 participants, so maybe I should add reason 3, not attending the lecture, right? I think some of you, you're probably watching the video, but I mean, we do a lot of stuff here that's really useful for the exercise, and I also explain a lot of things, right? Of course, the exercises, in a sense, they are self-contained. You read them, but then you miss something, and then you spend many hours just because you missed something. So I would recommend attending the lecture. It's not so bad, and I think it helps with this spending so many hours on the sheets. They are not so hard. So now it's about a web application, so something like this, right? I've now disabled JavaScript in this browser. We're not talking about JavaScript today, that's next week. So now I can type something and search it, right? So how does this work? You type something in the browser and then you get back another page where you have your query and your results, right? How do you do this? And we will do this with what you have done for the last exercise sheet. So the first thing is socket communication. And now, lots of things involved. I will explain them one by one, and then we will code it together. And you have to help me, please, because, so that we manage. So why do we need socket communication? Well, there are at least two processes or programs involved communicating with each other. This is on my machine. I'm typing something. It's sending something to Google server. Yeah, which server? I don't see it here. This sends something back to me. So there are at least two machines involved communicating over the network, right? So, and here it's the browser asking for a static web page. In the next lecture, there will be code running here in this web page, and the code will ask the server, right? Today it's a static. So the endpoint, you have two machines talking with each other, and like this is where they are connected. You call this a socket. Yeah, and the socket has a particular port on the machine. Why does it have a port? Because this one machine might want to talk to 500 other machines doing things concurrently, totally different things, right? Different users, different applications, and each endpoint of a communication channel is called a port, and it just has a number, right? Actually, this number here, it's implicit here. If I would type 80 here, it doesn't work, okay, because we will come back to this in a second. So the high-level procedure is, we are now on the server, so what's the code running at Google? You create a socket and bind it to a given port. So now you are listening on that port for incoming requests, and then some client can connect. It just needs to know the phone number, send you something, you read it, you compute something, you send it back. On the client side, you connect to that socket, you need the machine name and the port. Now the client, which is now the web browser, also needs a port. This will be assigned automatically, sends a request and waits for the result. Let's now code this together. So all the three languages. I mean, this is pretty involved code if you do it low level yourself, but all the languages have libraries for this, and we are going to use them. For Python, it's called socket. For Java, JavaNet, server socket or client socket. We are writing the server. for C++, it's a boost SEO, yeah, if you don't want to do it low level. Asynchronous is important, and we will talk about this more in a second. So this we will provide for you. You don't have to write it yourself. Also, yeah, this basic stuff, but still we will do it together now. So Python is again not an option because you have to integrate your code from the last lecture, this prefix fuzzy search. If you have spare time, just implement what we did for last week in Python. It will take 1,000 times longer, right? And for 3 million entities, does not work. That's why we didn't use Python. Okay, let's, yeah, maybe. So this is how, yeah, let's code it together now. This is, I think I just put it here and we go directly to the code. So let's go to the code, public code. It's lecture 6 today and Java. I've prepared something already. So this is just a lot of imports, socket, blah, blah, blah. We give this to you, what's here. I've just prepared a little bit. Let's just go through it very quickly so that you know what is there already. So yeah, we just want to call this server and say, listen on a certain port, listen for requests, right? Here I'm parsing the integer argument if it's given. And now I'm creating the server socket. So I'm actually listening. Let's just see whether we can compile it until here. And yeah, unused import, okay. Oh, build failed. I think, yeah, because I'm not using all the stuff which I'm using later. Maybe I can jar. Yeah, it should work anyway. So let's just call it and see what's happening. Now I'm just creating the socket and then nothing else. Search server. Mm-hmm. Oh, search, I think I renamed it. Sorry, what did I rename? Search. Demo server, right? I think it's the mistake in the build. Yeah, I first called it demo server. Yeah, here. Search server main. Thank you. Let me just clean this. Let me compile it again and not do the. This works. And let me build the jar. Okay, let's call it again. Okay. Hmm. I'm sorry, what's the. Oh, I just used it from the history, right? Okay, now it works. Now let's take port 888 and run it, and now it's running, right? So now I've created a socket and it's listening on this port and nothing is happening, right? So now I'm listening on a port and now I write the typical server loop. What is the server loop? I'm just waiting for someone to call me on port 888, right? And this is, I've already prepared this. This is what this line is doing. Socket, client, server, accept. This is blocking, yeah? I'm now waiting that someone calls me on line 8, on port 888. There may be other programs listening on other ports, right? So this waits until someone calls. When someone calls, I will say, who called? They have an internet address. And then, this is important, they will talk to me. It's also on the slide. And maybe they decide to. Let me first not use this, and then we see what happens. Let's just, this be it for now, right? I'm just accepting the call and say that I've accepted the call. Let's just compile this and compile jar and okay. And maybe I should write something that I'm so that we see what's happening, right? This will become more involved as we go on. Waiting for request on port. And then some dot, dot, dot. Okay, and maybe we shouldn't call it. Let's see if this works. Yeah, now I'm waiting for a request. Now, how do I call this machine? well, how do you call it? There's a, let me go on the slides. On the client side, we are building the server, now we need something to call it, and this is what the web browser does. Before we go to the web browser, let's do it with another simple communication program, one that has been around for a very long time, Telnet. Yeah? Telnet is just calling a machine, and you just give the name of the machine and the port. Yeah? That's like a phone number. So let's just do this. Let's go on another machine, Aetna here. It's the same machine, but a different process, but let me just go to a different machine, Stromboli, for example. Now let me just call Aetna. So the host name, it's an internal network here, Informatik Privat, that's the host name, and let me call it on 888. So now I've called it, right? Now let's see what's happening on the server side. Ah, you see it jumped to the next line, yeah? So what a client connected from here, so this is the IP address of the other machine, of Stromboli, yeah, 10.8, so it's a private address. And yeah, I didn't do anything, right? I just wrote client connected, and then I went to accepting the next call. So I just accepted the call, and then I'm waiting for the next call. So now if I want to, yeah, hello, yeah, nothing is happening. Yeah. So the other side just not responding, not doing anything. Okay, so the next thing we should do is, yeah, we should, and let's not do the timeout for now. I should read what the other side is sending me or telling me. So in Java, you do it like this. Input new buffered reader. So the client has an input stream, that's just what they are sending me. And now, well, this is asynchronous, so what's being sent is now, yeah, not necessarily sent in one batch, but maybe in several packets. But let me maybe just start by reading one line first. So string line is input read line, and then let me just print this line and see what happens, right? Okay, let's go step by step because a lot of interesting things are happening. Network communication is tricky. So now I'm doing the same thing. Ah, I killed the program, so this connection was killed as well. Now I'm calling the machine again, client connected, and now I'm now it's in the read line call. Yeah, it's waiting for this here to say something. I'm here, so let's hi there. But oh, some of you are having fun with the server already, right? This is a web browser. We will come back to this in a second. Yeah. Nice, yeah. You see, this is now in a loop and accepting requests from everywhere, except if you are inside the network. So, hi there, I received this, right? Now I'm typing more. Yeah, you see, now it's not responding, and I think it's also not arriving because the loop already went on, right? It doesn't listen to this connection anymore. It already started a new connection, and yeah. So somehow we have to be a bit careful here, more careful, right? So just reading one line does not work. We have to do this in a loop. We have to read more lines. So how does it, yeah, let's do a line like this. String line, input read line, and let's maybe string, yeah, we somehow want to concatenate these. I think you do it with a string builder, and this is my request. This is how you do it in Java. You have a string builder because concatenating strings is not efficient. You do it with a string builder, so I read line after line. If, let me just, now, yeah, the client wants to tell me something, I need a protocol when to stop. Let's just stop when an empty line is sent, right? if line equals empty line, then a break, right? And so I read line after line, and then I just request append, I think is the, and then I just append it to my string builder, right? This is my request builder. Yeah, and now I have my request here, string. This is what I have been asked, and it's just a request builder to string. I'm just asking the string builder, right? So, and let's just print the request here, right? Okay, let's do it again. Null, interesting things. You're having fun with my little server here. That's great. So, let's call it again from here. Hello. Yeah, we are still, how are you? And now I'm sending a new line. Okay, and now, yeah, after the new line, it that was my protocol, right? I'm sending something, it's writing it here. It's not what happened to the new lines. I guess with the read line, they got lost somehow, right? Okay, but that's fine. Okay, this worked. Now, I think, when am I going to explain this? I think I'm going to explain it now. Okay, something is happening here. A null pointer exception. That's interesting, right? Actually, we spent quite some time yesterday to understand why this is happening. I mean, this looks simple enough, right? A client sending something, you read it, but it's complicated, right? Because several people can try to talk to you. Let's do one thing to show you what's complicated. Let me do it again and do it here. Let me talk to it here. Yeah, I say hello. I haven't typed the empty line yet, so it's still waiting. And now let me go to another machine. And also, yeah, this is now somewhere else. Someone else also wants to call. And now I'm, yeah, what's happening? This is it's not getting a connection, right? Because, yeah, this is not arriving here because the line is busy, right? So someone is calling me and not saying anything, right? They don't stop. So they are blocking the line, right? And since I'm in this while loop without using threads or anything, I'm this other person cannot reach me. So if I write a web browser here, it would be hung, right? I'm in an infinite loop. So that's why I should have a timeout here. That's the reason for the timeout. So if somebody talks to me and they don't send me something within 1 second, then I will just time out. Or let's take 5 seconds for now, because we are doing it via Telnet. Let's just compile this and run it again. So now I'm waiting for something. This can take longer than 5 seconds. This is just waiting for someone to call me. But when they call me, now someone called me. I'm waiting for them to tell me something, right? And now I'm waiting for 5 seconds, and afterwards I get this socket timeout exception, right? So I have to catch it. I have to do this here. And this, there's no way around this. You have to do this, right? I have to try reading a line. And if they don't send me something within 5 seconds, as I specified above, let me just copy this. I have to catch, and you have to do similar thing in C++, but we will provide this code for you. But I think you should understand this. And then, yeah, let me just go out of the loop for now, right? And let me just write what happened. So time out. Right? Read timeout, yeah? So, okay, let's do do that, let me compile it. And append line, what's wrong now? I did a cannot find symbol. I've done something. Ah, the line is now defined inside the try block only. Okay. Yeah, now I'm here. Now I'm calling it. I'm not saying anything. Let's see what happens. Waiting 5 seconds. Okay, read timeout, waiting for the next request. That's important. If you don't do this, you're, yeah, nice, somebody calling me again, right? Yeah, see, somebody else talking to me and sending me something with a proper protocol. Yeah, sending something, then empty line. Yeah, read timeout, calling, not sending something. That way my server remains functional, right? We did some important things here. One other, yeah, I think we can leave it at that for now. And that way it's not blocked, right? Oh, this one is still waiting. Okay, but now I should be able, somebody there. Does this work now? Ah, this is from an earlier version of the program. Yeah, I think this connection is gone, but it's still, yeah, you see, I mean, this was from 5 versions ago. I call this connection is still there, but the other side is not there anymore, but Telnet is just waiting forever. This is something which a browser has to deal with, right? And somebody there. Why is this not closing? Okay, now the next thing is, I think we can leave it at this. We should send an answer, right? Now we get a request, let's just send something. And that's the code below here. I'm sending something. So I just, the client has an input stream, I can read something, an output stream, I can send something. That's how you do it in Java. And let me just, have a, okay. Nice weather today, isn't it? And let me just send it, and let me send it as a byte sequence. Yeah? Because when you write to the output, you have to send bytes, so this is how you do it in Java. I need some, I have to specify the encoding. We'll talk about this in the next lecture. And yeah, let's just do it and see what happens. So now I'm getting something and I'm sending something. I'm compiling it. Response content string. Okay, I should have called it response. I'm sending the response. Wait for a request. I'm calling it from here. Hi there. Still waiting for something. I have to give an empty line to say I've done speaking, so a pause. Nice weather today, isn't it? Right? Can you say anything else? Okay, now, I'm still with the old connection. This already went on to the next collection, and I get another null pointer exception. Why do I get the null pointer exception? So another client connected here. Let's also, since we get it again, we should just catch it here. The problem is that you're reading something from the client here, and the client may be no longer available, right? So you might get a null here. So you have to deal with that too. Yeah? This read line, yeah, somebody called you, and now you're waiting, and now somehow they went away. They are not, the connection is no longer there. So we can deal with it by saying, actually, this is where the null point exception comes from. This read line here returns null. So line is null. So when I refer to it, it doesn't work. So if line is null, or an empty line is sent, I just stop the connection, right? And maybe, yeah? Say it again. Yeah. Anyway, I wanted to change it. Let me just to make it more transparent. System out print line connection terminated by client, right? This is what's happening here. And then I break. And then I also have, this is the regular, right? This is just my protocol. When they send me an empty line, I also break, right? And now I shouldn't have that problem anymore. Okay. Yeah, let's just do this once again. Now I shouldn't get this null pointer exception anymore. Let me just compile it again and write it again. I'm calling the machine here. Hello. Hello. Yeah, I have to stop speaking, which means new line. Nice weather today. Anything. Mm-hmm. Anything else? New line, now I don't get anything anymore, right? Because this has already finished this connection and now listening to another call. That's how I implemented the protocol on the server side. And this is someone else connecting here, not saying anything, but I don't get any null pointer exceptions anymore. Okay, a timeout because they didn't say anything. Yeah, you can try to break it. That's great. Let's see. Okay. I think this is the basic server loop. We have already done a lot now on our way to writing a small web server. Yeah? A lot of things we had to think about because a lot of things, and also for the exercise sheet you have to do this, but I think we provide this code for you. So now let's go to the slide. So what... Okay, another way to talk to machine is to enter something in the browser. You may wonder how things work in the browser. So I can do the same thing here if I type HTTP and then the name of my host, which is Aetna Informatik Privat, and now slightly different syntax, a colon and then the port. And now I send something. And let's see what's happening. Now, this I see this here, yeah? And let me just add a few new lines so that it's a bit nicer to see. We just have a new line here and maybe a new line here so that it's not so convoluted. And let's do it again. Let's compile it. And let's call it again. And now again, I'm a You see what happened here? Just by typing this in the browser, this also means call this machine on this port and send something. And what is being sent? This string is being sent, yeah? It's a so-called GET request, yeah. Hi, great. Yeah, looking forward to what you will do in a second. So, yeah, this is what the browser sends. This is not via the browser. This is via Telnet or some. Or which program? Oh, you don't want to be. You want to stay anonymous, I'm sure. So this is what the browser is sending, a GET request, right? What is a GET request? So usually you type this and then you type some file.html, right? You usually type a file name here. So what happens now? Now I get this, right? So the browser is asking the server, get some file HTML, asking for this file on this machine, and then some information about the browser, about the protocol, it's HTTP 1.1, the host is blah, blah, and so on, right? But this is the important part for us now, right? So this is, the browser is doing nothing else than calling the machine and telling it, give me a page, right? So, let's go to the slides. Yeah, and this protocol, I mean, you have to somehow agree on the syntax of this, that it's called GET, and then some file, and then all this. This protocol is called HTTP. Let's talk a bit about the protocol, and then we continue implementing it, right? So this is how a typical request looks like when you type something in the browser. GET, this is everything after the initial part, domain and port. And actually when you leave out the port, you just write dot 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 something, it's port 80, right? And then, yeah, search HTML. And now let's send something to the browser, right? And this is also part of the protocol. When you send something, you don't just send something, but you prefix it with a header like this. You say, okay, I'm also using HTTP 1.1, 200, okay, everything went fine. You say, how many bytes am I going to send? What's the content type? We'll talk about this in a second. And then the bytes you want to send. And there's a new line in between. I should write this here. New line in between. Empty line in between. In between, I think. Okay, and then now let's So actually, why? Yeah, you see the browser doesn't display this, and now let's go one step further, I think. Let me go to this. I mean, my protocol worked with Telnet, but it doesn't work with the browser, right? Why? It says, actually, a few years back, I would have seen something here. It would have just displayed it, but here it says, hat eine ungültige Antwort gesendet. Yeah, got received an invalid response. Why? Because I was just sending a string and without these proper headers. This we are going to use a lot in the rest of the lecture, a development console where we can see what's actually happening in the browser. So in all the browsers, it works with F12 and also some other key combinations. Let's just do it here and see what's happening. And there are a number of tabs here, and we will look at the network tab, right? Network, this is what's being sent back and forth between the browser and some other machine. Elements tab, we don't need it today, and the console for JavaScript, we'll talk about, I think this is also lecture 7. We don't need this today. We just look at the network tab, so what's actually happening. And let's just do this. This only shows something for the future request, not for the past request. So now I'm, yeah. Yeah, this is sending images, but not some file. Actually, I don't understand why. I would have expected to see some file here. I'm not sure about the images. Why don't I see some file.html now? I'm a bit confused. Do you have an idea? Let's come back to this in a second and maybe fix our... let me send something with proper response headers first, and let's see what's happening in the browser console. So I have to build a proper response conforming to the standard. So let's response builder, new string builder. It's just the same thing here. And let's, okay, response. So in the beginning, I need this here. Yeah, HTTP 1.1, 200, okay. This is what I have to send. HTTP 1.1/1.1/200, okay. 200, okay. Now I have to send the content length. Yeah, and let me, I need the content band length in bytes. This will be important. So bytes response bytes and this is the response string. Response bytes string, and now I need to I need this stuff below here. Get bytes. So let me send the bytes. So now I have the content length is just the response bytes length, right? It's just the number of bytes I'm sending. And in the standard, it actually says that you should encode a new line like this. It also works if you do it with a single new line, but for now. And now the content type. Okay, for now. Let me have a variable here, content type. And let me just set it to content type is text. Okay, I have to let me go to that slide. You have to say what kind of data you are sending. Maybe you're sending a web page, maybe you're sending text, maybe you're sending an image. So you have to communicate the type. So for now I want to send a text, so that's called text plain, right? This is what you have to say here, text plain. I'm sending plain text. Now I have to send a new line, an empty line. So headers are done. I think that's how I do it. And now I'm there's a mistake.
When you create response builder, it's response builder.
Yeah, that's why the auto completion didn't work. Thank you. Thank you. So now let me send the header or write the header to the output. Response. Let me actually call this header builder. I think this is the header builder, right? I'm building the header here. Header builder. Header builder. And now I'm writing. I need to extract the string, and then I'm sending the bytes. Encoding is important because I might have some special characters here, right? And now I'm writing the actual response. Response bytes. Yeah? I think. And now I have to close the connection, or at least I should. So now I just. I'm sorry, I just sent the proper headers and then I sent the what I actually want to send. Let's see, let's compile this. I think there's just one parenthesis too many. Header builder is should be string builder, not string. I'm sorry. Bytes cannot find symbol. Byte. Oh, it's just byte. Yeah. Thank you. The type is byte. It's char array, right? So many mistakes. Cannot find what's wrong here. Oh, I think the length of byte array is not a function, but just a. Now it works. Okay, now let's enter this again in our browser. Bang. Now I get something. Yeah, I asked, let's see what's happening in our, yeah? So I got this request here for some file, because that's what I typed in the address bar. And then I send this request, and now this works as well. So before, it didn't even show it. So if I click on this here, and now I can also look at all the headers here, right? So this is, you will need this for the exercise sheet. So these are the headers which I sent. So actually, yeah, this is what the browser sent to me, which you saw there, in packed together in one string. And this is what I sent, right? It's exactly what I sent. Ah, actually I made a mistake here. I didn't send a new line after OK, but it still accepted it. That's very nice. Of the, yeah, browsers are very, I should have put, you can actually see it here. I'm missing the new line here. You see, there's no new line here, and there should be one, and the browser still understood it. So let me just do it again. And let's just repeat it, F5, and click on it again, and view source, and now it worked, yeah? This is exactly what I sent, HTTP, okay, new line, content length 29, it's just the number of characters in this, context type, text, plain. Right? And here I can see the response. Yeah? And it also sent another request, right? The browsers do it asked me for an icon, right? Fav icon ICO is just what would be displayed here if I send a picture. Mm-hmm. But I don't have one, so this request just got the same. Yeah? I'm sending nice weather today, isn't it, to whatever I'm being asked for now, right? So the Fav icon. Yeah, it's accepting it, but can't really make a picture out of it. Any questions so far? Now we go to the next level. So, yeah, what do we actually want to do now? We, let me go back to the, yeah, let me mention this. There are many more request types. So this is GET. There's also POST, if you have much longer requests that are not part of the URL. We don't do this here. There are also many more headers which you can send back, not found, forbidden. We'll come back to this in a second. And I already talked about the content type. I've already talked about the console. We have just done this. And now, yeah, we actually want to send back a web page, right? So that's how a web page looks like. It's in an XML-like language using these tags, opening and closing tags. And let's just, and here's some standard things of HTML, a header, a paragraph, an input field, and so on. Let's just write a simple web page now, and let's give it back to the browser. So let me just write test HTML here. Edit anyway, okay. Yeah, so this is how it looks like, HTML, and now we have a body section, and let's just, my first search engine, so that's just a header thing. And now let's have an input field here. This will just create a search field where I can type something, and let that be it for now. So that's a web page. Yeah? So this is called test.html. And if the browser asks me for test.html, I want to return this. Yeah? So let's just implement this. So this should be returned to the browser. For now, I always say, yeah, not some file, but when I type this, I want this file, the file with the same name in this directory. For now, I always get this sentence. So how do I do this? Well, how does the what I get from the browser looks like this, get. So I have to strip off this get, I have to strip off everything after here, and I have to extract this file name. Yeah? You are sending me more requests, you are anxiously waiting for what I'm to code now so that you can exploit it viciously. So let's, extract the file name from the get request and serve the file. Let's do that, right? So how do I do this? I have my request. So if the request should start with get, right? If not, starts with get space. That's just how it looks like. Yeah. Yeah, get space, then I'm not going to answer it, right? So you will have to use your browser from now on to communicate with me. Yeah, I only system.println outprintln. I only answer get requests. And then for now, let me just continue. Yeah, I just listen to the next request. Let's see what that does. So, and let me not print this. Let me actually do it this way. Let me. Yeah, actually, I could. My response bytes. Let me actually define them here. Yeah, response bytes. And actually, I can make that my response, right? Response bytes is this string here. Or maybe I should do it in two steps. So this is my response string. I only answer get, and my response bytes are response string dot get bytes UTF-8, right? And then I will just skip to the sending part, right? So else, now I have a real get request. So what do? I just strip off, so that's a request substring. The first 4 bytes I want to strip off, and then I also want to strip off everything. where am I? Yeah, after starting from space HTTP, I'm not interested in that part. I only want to extract that part here. Actually, I also don't want the slash, so let me also extract this, so the first 5 characters, right? So let me do this, 5, and then request index of, this is searching the, so now I'm just assuming that it will continue like this, which is, I think, safe when it's coming from a browser. And now let me just print this and see what's happening. Out, yeah, request string is request, and let me not do anything else, and let me build the let me put that part here. For now, I'm still sending this response here. Yeah, let's see how this works. 76, what's my mistake? Oh, this was already defined. Let's see what's happening now when I type test HTML. Okay, yeah, this seems to work nicely. Okay, I get this get request and I'm extracting the test HTML, right? I successfully extracted it. Okay, so, and I think I want another new line here so that it's nicer to look at. Try to find the file on the system. File on the system. How do I do that? I think I do it with this in Java. I first have to find the file. I think it works like this. So let me see if that file exists, and then if files, first I want to see if it's a regular file and not a directory, and if it's actually readable. I think that's is readable, is that the right syntax? We will see. So if this is readable, and now I just check whether test.html exists on my file system. And then actually I have prepared this here. Let me just copy it. Here. This is for reading the contents of just the byte content of a yeah, this was one too many, I'm sorry. So this is just reading the file now. And maybe I should call this file name here. Or I should call it file name above. No, let me call it. Yeah, I'm opening the file now. I'm reading from the file. I'm reading the content. Content bytes, here I call it content bytes. I think I should call it yeah, content is a better word. Let me call it content. Content string, sorry. And content bytes, I think that's better than content bytes, I read the bytes. Okay, yeah, I just read the bytes from the file, right? And that's my contents now. So, yeah, there's a mistake.
Still need to rename response string in the first place.
Down here, can you tell me the...
line 70,
yeah. Yeah, thank you. Yeah, I renamed it to content string now, and now I have... here it's also content bytes. I think that's more content bytes. And here it's also content bytes, right? Let's see if this compiles, and then we look at it again. In line? 70. Thank you. Thank you for paying attention. More mistakes. Cannot find symbol, paths. Oh, this was here. Huh? Dot get, ah, okay. That's how you get the path of a, that's just Java syntax. Wow, I'm making a lot of mistakes here. Line 70, content bytes. Ah, here it should also be content bytes. Okay. Oh, we are getting there. Variable content bytes might not be initialized. Actually, I'm in, okay, Java is a bit strict here because I have two parts, if and else, and in both I'm assigning it. Ah, no, no, in case if the file doesn't exist here, I will not initialize it. So let me just... initialize it with nothing, just in case. Okay, so what did we do? I'm extracting that part from the GET request, and then I try to read that file and return the contents. So that's what I'm doing now. So let's... did I compile? Yeah, it compiled, right? Let me start our server. And now... yeah. It returns my file, it worked, right? So It's also looking for a FAV icon. It's not getting it, but this works, right? It sent this request. I was extracting test HTML. I was reading the file and returning it. And here's my web page. It's not quite what I imagined, right? Because it's showing the markup. What did I do wrong? Let's look at the test HTML. I mean, it's sending. What's wrong? Yeah. Not the request, but the response header, right? I said this is text plain and Chrome is just taking me literally, right? It displays it as plain text, but actually I wanted to... But that's easy. Now we are almost there. Yeah, we've spent a lot of time, but it's always like this. We've built the foundation and now we can do advanced things pretty quickly because now everything is there. We already have a variable for a content type here. So let me just make my default content type text plain. So if I don't change it, then I will just send text plain. Oh, I could have just copied this line. But here, okay, now I should, yeah, I guess I should make it dependent on the suffix, right? So if my request, and since we are reading, if request ends with .html, and this is also how your web server will do it, for example, yeah, if the file requested ends with HTML, then I will say the content type is HTML, text HTML, right? It's plain text and it's HTML. Okay, so I just change the content type if a .html file is requested. Let's see how this works. Let's see if it compiles. It compiles. We are getting better. Here we have a request, and now... Buck. Yeah, we are getting closer. My first search engine, I have a search field. I can type something here, nothing happens. Right, but now it has the right text HTML. So, nobody else is sending requests. Okay. Now, you might get an idea. So I could ask for other files, right? Test HTML. I might, let's do XXX HTML. It's not there. If I look at it here, it says, what am I doing if the file is not there right now? Let's look at our code. What happens? If the file is not there, I don't do anything. It will just return these 0 bytes here, right? So I should have an else part here. So let's just do that. Yeah, if else... So this was the part where file exists, is a regular file and readable, right? And then I returned it. I should also do something with the other part. So this is a file not found. And there's a header for this. This was on one of the previous slides. I should just return not found. Yeah, and actually there's a... So here, I was sending HTTP 11200 OK. And if I don't find something, I just send a slightly different header, right? And let me just... So this is my... How do I call this? The very first line of the header? Do you have a good name for it? Status? Maybe I call it the status, right? So it's the... So this is when everything goes wrong. Everything goes right. This is a status string. Okay. And actually, I will have this down there. And here I just write the append status string with a plus like this. And now if something goes wrong, I will just send a different status stream, right? Is 404 not found? Let's just do this. File not found. See, does it compile? It compiles. We're getting better. So what? Now I'm asking for a triple X. And now it's red, right? So now it actually red. Yeah, it got a regular 404 not found. This is nice. So, here's another idea. You see, you have to pay attention when you write a server. Yeah? What did I do? This is etc pass cvd. Yeah? Yeah. What did I do? I just extracted this part, checked if the file is there anywhere on my file system. Now it's slash something, and then I'm reading the file and returning it. You really have to pay attention, right, when you write a web server. Now this doesn't really contain any passwords, so it's not that bad, but you have to pay attention. So how do we deal with this? You should somehow be careful on what you allow and what you don't allow. And there's also provisions for this. We can just, let's just check that the file name only consists of letters, that it doesn't contain any slashes, right? So where do we do this? Maybe, and let me maybe do it like this. So if request, what's the syntax? Match or matches, or what's the regular expression matching in Java? Can you look? So if this does not match, yeah, and let me just request that it contains these letters, and a dot is also okay for now, and plus. And then I will just say forbidden. Right? Forbidden. Huh?
It's actually matches.
Matches. Thank you very much. And then I can just send a 403, yeah? Go away. Actually, that's free, whatever right here. Else if, and let me do this the other way around. If not this, I think that's nicer to do it this way, yeah? So if the file name contains anything suspicious, I'm saying forbidden. If it's not found, I'm saying not found, and otherwise I'm returning it, right? So we are getting closer and closer to something really good. So let's see what's happening now. Now we're getting better and better. Now I get a 403, right? And with a console, I can look at this in detail. When I would do it like this, yeah? Now it just says forbidden. Or if I do XXX, that's how you get these numbers, right? Now you say, XXX, why do I get verweigert? No, was not found, right? HTTP error 404. Now, actually, let me just check whether this works. Actually, I also have a picture here, forbidden PNG. Let me try to serve a picture. This should also work. Let me just, I mean, now that we have written so much, we can really do advanced stuff pretty. Yeah, so else, if it ends with a PNG, I mean, we are reading the file and returning the contents of the file with the right headers, right? The right length, the right type. So we just have to put a right content type here, which is image PNG, if it ends with a PNG, and then I'm returning an image, right? Let's just see if this works, if we can return an image. So that's my... what did I do wrong? If, else if. Let's see, forbidden. Now I'm returning an image. It works. Okay, forbidden PNG. Yeah, so image also works. It's just, let's look at the development console. I have to do it again, I think, to see it here. Yeah, this is now asking for the picture. It's returning the contents of, it's just a file, right? It has 159,080 bytes, image PNG, and this is just the contents of the file, right? It just works just the same. Why did it work? I took some precautions here to send bytes, right? If I have a string, I first convert it to bytes. When I send a picture, if I would first convert this to a string and send it, it would not work, right? Actually, I can just send this as the forbidden picture, right? Let me just do this here. If it's forbidden, I will just send a picture, and then we go on. How do I do this? Well, if I forbidden, then I just set the request to forbidden PNG, and then I just go on. Then I don't, I just do it like this, right? If my request contains something suspicious, I just change it to forbidden PNG, and then I continue with the code. If it's not found, so let's just do this, and then compile it, right? We can do, I did another mistake, why? I forgot to close my parentheses here. Let me now start my server, and let me, so my test HTML is still there. Let me just, yeah? Let me request something which is not there. I get not found. And let me do something nasty now. I get this, yeah? It worked. So you can also return a picture if you, Okay, nice. So now it's already pretty safe, so we have a bit more time, but we are almost done. It's just 4 more slides, because it's only about the static version. So this is already a pretty decent web server we have written, right? It can return pictures, can return 404, 403, it returns any file type, and it's very easy to extend, right? I mean, now another file type, I just add another 2 lines here, it just works. This is pretty functional already. That's a pretty good web server already. So what else? CSS, we want to add some style. Yeah, some major style. There are no colors here. Let's add some color. Let's make this line blue. How do you do this? And let me look at my development console here. There's a thing called style sheet, so you can have style for a web page. And it's actually very easy. Yeah. In the head section, we didn't have a head section so far in our HTML, you just put a link to a style sheet. Let's do that first. I always forget the syntax, so let me just copy this here. Yeah, and let's go to our test. Yeah, this was our HTML so far. You can also have a head section here, which just contains a yeah, okay, I need to go into paste mode here. Yeah, this will now just include a style sheet. And let me just call this test.css. And let's see what's happening. So I'm just adding this to my HTML file. And actually, I don't have to recompile the server. I just changed one of the files, right? So let me just do this again. Test CSS aborted. Why is aborted? What's the problem? It's red. Huh? There are two problems, right? It's not found and it's also the wrong MIME type. Should be text CSS. And it's also not found. So let's fix both of them. Let's first add the right MIME type. So if I'm a CSS file, and then should be text CSS, right? Why does it happen, by the way? I mean, this gets this file now, and in the head section of this file, it says also load this file. So it's issuing another GET request, right? Although I was only asking for one file here, in that file, I had commands which told the browser load more file, this test CSS, and it didn't find this, right? So now I serve this. And now, let me also write this. Let's write a simple CSS file. It's super hard. For example, this says all header one tags. You see, there was a header one tag here, which just means first level header. Make them, I think the syntax is like this, right? Color blue. This is very simple, yeah? Everything uses a different syntax in, oh my, why does this have a funny color here? I don't understand it, but yeah, these are brackets. Can you see it? I'm not sure why it's highlighting it. Okay, now it's gone. Now I wrote this CSS file, and let me just, now it's blue, yeah? So what happened? I loaded this file, the first in the header section it says, also load this style file, test CSS. I just wrote it, my fancy web server returned it, and in that CSS file, if I look at it, it actually says make the header, the first level headers blue, yeah? Great. Yeah, you can also make change the font where you can change everything, right? And you should play around with it a little bit in the exercise sheet. It's called cascading because they can be nested, right? For big websites. Okay. So, one last thing, you have a question?
Why did it work without recompiling the CSS?
Why did it work without recompiling the server code? Ah, good question. Didn't I recompile it? Let's see. Oh yeah, you're right. See, that's an interesting thing. Browsers are robust with some things and not with others. That's actually wrong here, right? You're right. I'm returning it with the wrong content type, but it's still accepting it as CSS, right? But the browser, we have seen it in other places, it complained, right? So let's just, if we recompile it now, so browsers can choose to how robust they are, else without if. Where is this? I forgot the parentheses here. It's a good question, so. And now I will probably get the right, yeah, now it's text CSS and it still works. Good comment. So one last thing, and then we are done for today, and you can work on the nice exercise sheet. So now we want some action to happen, right? I want to type something, and nothing is happening now. How do I make something happen here? So I need a search button now, and something should happen. So let's make that, but that's relatively easy. Let's first create a search button. That's just another element in HTML. And it's, so actually this here is a normal text field. You can also write it like this, but it's the default. And this is now another input field, and it's called submit, right? Submit, okay. And the value is, this is actually a button now, search. So now I don't have to recompile anything because it's just the contents here. Let me just do this. Now I have a search button here and nothing is happening. How do I make something happen? Well, you just put a form tag pair around this code and then action happens. So let's just do it. It's very easy. You just do form here. Yeah, in the next lecture we will do this dynamically. For now, this is the static version, how you did it, or you still do it when there is no JavaScript. So now it's just a form tag around it. Let's see what's happening when I'm typing something here. I'm pressing search. Oh. Now it's somehow changing the URL here. It added a question mark. Let's do something else. Let's put a name here. Namely, a query. And let's reload this. And type something here and search. And you see what happened? It changed the URL to test.html?query=. Yeah, that's just the query which I typed in the field and then the contents of the field, right? That's what the form does. So now I have this kind of request. And now all I have to do is change my server so that it does something meaningful with this kind of request, right? It should somehow parse the thing which comes after the file name. File name, question mark, yeah, this is what you see a lot in URLs. So, and right now, I mean, what is it doing right now? It's taking this whole thing as a file name and looking for the file and it's not finding it, right? So right now I get a 404, which is not probably what is intended. So let's do this last thing and then we are done. So how do we do this? Yeah, maybe we should do it here, I think. So if... Let's see if there's a question mark in the file name, right? So let's do it like this, pause, and let's search for index of question mark, right? Now, if there is, actually, let me be more specific. Let me, if now, let me do it like this. So if this is the case, and then let me strip off this part, right? Let me call this parameters, everything after the question mark, string parameters. So if, I think I'm in the wrong mode here. Now it works again, okay. If there is a question mark, which means this is not -1, this returns -1 if no question mark is found, then I should strip this off the file name. So let me enter, or first, the rest now are my parameters, so that's a request, pause, +1, I don't want the question mark, I think, and request, yeah, I just take the part until the question mark, right? So the regular file name. Okay, and otherwise it's just the empty string. Okay, so and now let me yeah, maybe let's do it until here and compile this. What's happening now? Request substring, right? Forgot this here. So what's happening now? I have parameters here. It still didn't work. Why doesn't it work? Somehow my stripping off didn't work. Does somebody see the problem? Let me just I'm looking for a question mark in the We're almost done. Does somebody see the problem? It's probably where in line? In line 80. Ah, okay. I'm already using it up here. I see. Ah. So I should do this here, right? And should do this stuff before. Is that what you're saying? Yeah. Okay. Yeah, I should check for a question mark part, right? If there's a question mark, then I strip it off. And now I have to extend the regular expression, exactly, because otherwise I will have to allow a question mark, right, and an equal sign. Okay, that's a good point. Mm-hmm. Check the file name. Mm. Okay, let's try this. Our server, and now Yeah. So what happened now? I just stripped this off, right? Now I just stripped this off, but yeah, nothing. Yeah, this works now. I get the URL here with the parameter appended, and I just show the same page again because I'm doing nothing with it. That's the last thing I will do now. That's easy. How do I do something with a string? Well, I could do the following, and this is also something you should do for the exercise sheet. I can just, let's do the following here. I just introduced a template mechanism here, like a temp. This is something I'm doing for my code now, right? I'm introducing this variable query here. This is actually the value, what's written in the text input field, right? And now I'm, the CSS, I don't need it anymore. And what I will do now, if yeah, where am I? Here I've read the file, right? Let me just do this here. So if my file name is text HTML. Now what do I do? I have my parameters. Now I can just content. Yeah, let me just convert this bytes to a string like this. Content bytes. I have to specify the encoding, I think, like this. Thank you for your patience. We are almost done. And then in that string, I just replace all. I can just replace, there's just one occurrence, but I just replace this query thing by my params. This will now include the query equals part, I think, but let's just see what happens. And then I write this back to my bytes again. Content. Yeah, this is something I have to do because content string get bytes. Because what I have to send in the end is bytes. That's important. Okay. So, let's see what's happening now. Does it compile? It does. We're getting better and better. Blah. Oh, nice. It says query here, but it's not replacing it by this. Why not? So this is because, yeah, this is clear. Why does it happen? Because I wrote it here. So this just means right percentage query there. But actually what this code was supposed to do is replace it by what came after the question mark. So if you tell me why, then we can stop afterwards. HTML. Oh, it's text.html, not test.html. You should always code with an audience. It's much faster. It helps you finding all the, especially if Claudius is there. That's even. Ah, but it still didn't work. So somehow, yeah, I want this in the contents replaced. Equals test HTML content string is replace the right yeah, replace all. Ah, replace all is the right command. So replace was not correct. So here I have query equals. I didn't want that. Okay, now I'm done. Let me just so params is actually plus query has how many letters? 6. Yeah, now it works, right? So now I'm yeah, whatever I write here, it will be in the search field now. Yeah, it will be in there. Hello, Frank, we are almost done. And you can do the same with the result, right? What you can do for the exercise sheet, or what you have to do, at this point you have the query. Now you can just plug in the code from the last lecture here, get your results, and also, yeah, you will also have a percent result somewhere here, and then just substitute this with the results, right? Okay, that's it. Let me very quickly go to the exercise sheet. I'm sorry for again taking 5 minutes longer. Will not happen again. This is the exercise sheet. It's a less work, right? So this asks for writing the server code, which we have done today together. I will give you part of the code, not everything. And then you just have to implement a web page with an input field where you can type something. And then you get the results. It's all described here in detail. And you should add a style sheet and make it look nice and so on. So, yeah, I think the rest is... Are there any questions right now about the sheet? Yeah, please. The question is, can you use the HTTP APIs? Of course not. I mean, it's no fun, right? Then you don't understand what's happening. The point is that you should understand what's happening, that you write it yourself. I will give you half of this code. The other half, you do it yourself. You play around with the browser, and you see, oh, this is, yeah, you will make a few mistakes. You see what's happening. You understand it. Any other question right now? Yeah, please. Ah, very good question. You don't need any additional unit tests, only those from the code from the last lecture. And by the way, if you haven't done or finished the last exercise, you just use the master solution, right? So you don't have to do that again. You can always use the past master solutions. Any other questions? Okay, I hope you have fun with this sheet and see you next week. Bye-bye. Thank you.